Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. Welcome. Welcome to the Forum on the Hill. Thank you all so much for being with us today. I'm Mary Angela, the director of the Center on the Hill. I'm so glad you all are here for this month's forum. I've been looking forward to it for a while. So very excited today to welcome Dr. Joel Schwartz. He is the Emeritus Chair of Psychiatry at Abington Memorial Hospital. He received his medical degree from Hahnemann University Hospital and his psychiatric training at the Institute of Living and Hahnemann University. He is the recipient of the Herman Belmont Award for Excellence Teaching Child and Adolescent Psychiatry. He has been on the top docs list of Philadelphia Magazine several times and has received the United States Air Force Commendation Medal during his tour of duty in the U.S. Air Force. He is a distinguished fellow of the American Psychiatric Association. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Joel Schwartz.
Now, this is really very informative and interesting because you recognize the liars, the criminals, the adulterers, the murderers, the sluts, and the cheaters. However, you didn't know Jorge Bergoglio, who was the Pope. So, meanwhile, I lost one of the things I had here disappeared. What happened?
Something fell.
Anyway. When I was growing up, my mother said to me, I don't care what you do when you grow up, as long as you go to college or medical school and become a doctor. That was my marching orders. And so, on a regular basis, she would say things like, hickory dickory, doc. Jack be nimble, Jack be quick. Joel went to medical school and healed the sick. That was my marching orders. And When I went to school, maybe it was sixth grade, we had a Latin teacher who was maybe 4 feet tall, and she was 200 years old. And I said to the kid next to me, she probably dated Julius Caesar. Well, the kids in the class started to laugh. And it was an amazing feeling to have everybody laughing and enjoying what I said. So I came home and I said to my mother, I don't want to be a doctor. I want to be a comedian. After she stopped clutching her chest and breathing, she said to me, that's not a good job for a nice Jewish boy. I said, Mom, most of the comedians are Jewish. She said, that's because they couldn't get into medical school. So I had to give up and I went to medical school. And you know, you apply and you worry, are you going to get in or you're not going to get in? And finally, my acceptance came in. Let me get through this now. So that was my medical acceptance. And when I went to medical school, in the first couple of years, all they did was a lot of tests. And once a month, they would have a doctor come in and a specialist, and they would say, you know, if you get through the first couple of years, you could be, and then it was whatever the specialty was. The first person we had was an obstetrician. And I said, that's probably not going to be a specialty for me. Why should I be with women crying in pain and blaming me for their pain? I grew up with that. So that was out. And then we had a surgeon come in and talked about how great it was to operate on people. With these hands, no way could I be a surgeon. When I was in, I think, seventh grade, we had shop, and we made bird houses. None of the birds would live in my house. That was very upsetting. My father was a dermatologist, and he wanted me to be a dermatologist with him, and I couldn't see squeezing pimples my whole life, so that was something that was not good. And then the last person that we had to talk to us was a child psychiatrist, and he told the story of an 11-year-old girl who was sad and got picked on and had no friends. And he said to the girl, I want to tell you a story. There was a community and they had a donkey. And the donkey was old and they decided that they were going to get rid of the donkey. So the townspeople picked up the donkey and they dumped it in a well. And they decided they were going to bury it in this well. And they started to throw dirt on the donkey. And the donkey was screaming and braying. And all of a sudden the donkey stopped. And they looked in and they saw an amazing thing, because what was happening? They were throwing dirt on the donkey. It would go on the donkey's back. The donkey would go like this, shake the dirt off, and create a new floor. And they kept on doing this. And eventually, the floor got high enough, and the donkey jumped out of the well. And he said, this is what's happening to you. You are having people throw dirt on you. And I'm going to help you to shake it off and get friends and have people stop teasing you. And when I heard that story, I said, boy, that's amazing. That's a specialty. I could enjoy doing that. And so that's what happened. That's how I decided to go into psychiatry. But when I first started, I went to Hahnemann, as they said, and I interned at Albert Einstein medical center. And I can tell you that if you're going to get sick, do not get sick on July and August, because all the new interns and residents are there and they don't know anything. I didn't know a thing. And the worst part about it was they put me in the emergency room. That was my first rotation. That was scary. And I happened to pull duty on the 4th of July, and there were a lot of people in the emergency room. There were broken bones. There were seizures. There were automobile accidents, heart attacks, and I was scared to death. And then a nurse came over, and she said to me, "You got to see the person in room number 6. She's just been bitten by a black widow spider." Now, I can tell you, if there's one thing I did not learn in medical school, it was what to do about black widow spider bites. But the nurses were terrific. And they said, "We have a bookshelf. And maybe in this bookshelf, you'll find a book that can sort of give you an idea of what to do." And I looked, and sure enough, she was right. And I found this book, and it said what to do if somebody's been bitten by a black widow spider. Number one, wrap them in a warm blanket. Number two, put a tourniquet above the bite. Number three, put some ice in the area. And number four, rush them to the nearest hospital. So I sent them down to the University of Pennsylvania. Now actually, it didn't say that, and it turned out that the woman was just being bit by a black spider. It wasn't a black widow spider. I gave her some Benadryl, and she did well. But the interesting thing that happened, all the tension that we had on that day from the 4th of July and all the patients, everybody started to laugh. And the minute they started to laugh at that story, all the tension went away. And it just spread like wildfire all through the emergency room. And I had a valuable piece of information, and it just went right over my head, that humor could diffuse anxiety and tension, but I missed it. And it really wasn't until Norman Cousins, who was the editor of the Saturday Review, he got condition called ankylosing spondylitis. It was painful, it was debilitating, and he used to go to a room and watch videos from Alan Funt of Candid Camera. And Alan would send him each week, "This is what I'm going to do in my program." He would watch them, and he'd start to laugh and laugh, and at the end of the hour, he felt better. And he said, "You know, there's something to this." He left the hospital, went to a hotel, and for a number of weeks he was there watching funny videos, hearing funny tapes, and he started to feel better. Now, he didn't feel better instantly, but it took a period of time. And he started to write articles, and he had a book, Anatomy of an Illness, from a patient's perspective, and it was about how to use humor to help you when you're not feeling well. And he was really the first person to give you this insight and start people thinking about what are the values of humor and how it can help you. Well, when he was in the hospital, a nurse came and said, "Mr. Cousins, we need a urine sample." And she gave him a container. When she left, he noticed that there was some apple juice on the tray. So he took the apple juice and he poured it into the container. And when she came back, he gave her the container. So she looks at it, and she lifts it up, and she says, "You know, Mr. Cousins, your urine looks a little cloudy." He grabs it out of her hand, takes off the top, and drinks it, says, let me run it through again. 10 years later, they interviewed him and said, what do you remember about that? He said, well, I remember that, number one, the expression on the nurse's face. I mean, you can imagine how she looked. And number two, I remember that the apple juice was Mott's. But he was the person that said, let's look at humor, let's see what it can do, understand it from a psychological, from a biochemical standpoint, and he was really the beginning of what humor can be and how it can be helpful. So what can humor do? Well, they know that if you're laughing, it can increase your immune system. Immune system helps fight disease. What they would do is they would take people, they do saliva samples, and they measure immunoglobulins in the saliva, and then they divide the group up. One would go to a room, they watch history and science. In another room, they'd see funny videos. And then they'd measure the immunoglobulins a couple hours later, and the people who were laughing increase in immunoglobulins. So it's important that way. We all have beta endorphins. And you know, you talk to runners. Do we have any runners in here? Very healthy group here, I can see. Well, you hear runners talk about a runner's high. When they exert themselves, they get these endorphins released in their body. But they've also found out that if you laugh really hard, deep, sustained laughter, you increase the beta endorphins in your body. So it's really very helpful. So I'm going to give you a very important tip. Tomorrow morning, when you get up, go to the window and look outside. And when you see all the people running in the cold and in the rain, laugh at them. And you will get the same beta endorphin release that the people do running outside. William Fry was a psychiatrist from Stanford, and he found out that if you laugh 200 times for 10 minutes, 2,000 times, it releases the beta endorphins, and it was like 10 minutes on a rowing machine. So if you do it 400 times, it would be like 20 minutes. So you don't have to go to a health center or a fitness center. You don't have to buy a spandex outfit that doesn't fit. Just laugh, and you'll get exactly the same results. We know that it fights ulcers. People that have ulcers tend to have anxiety and upset in their life, and this helps protect them. We know that it increases oxygen to the heart, to the lungs, and to the brain, which is obviously important. What are the psychological benefits? Well, one of the psychological benefits is it makes you feel good. I mean, I know when I give a talk and people are laughing, I feel confident, I feel good. If you were in a relationship with one person or a group, you say things and they're laughing, makes you feel good. They know that there's an emotional bond that's created between you and the other person. If you see people laughing, it's almost like you can reach out and touch that bond. If you're laughing with your family or with a group of people, it's very important. And they know that marriages with humor have fewer divorces than marriages without you.
take Melissa when they come?
She be my waffle.
Be my waffle. Pancakey. I've been scared of this all my life.
Sometimes businesses will stop, let's say at lunchtime, take all their people, put them in a room, laugh, say funny things, then let them go back to business, and they're much more creative. And when you think about it, what about the your teachers? Who did you like the best? The ones that have great personality?
He can't hear you.
I'm sorry. The people that had the best personality, that would tell you stories or make you feel good, they were the ones that you tend to learn more, the ones that you remember. I mean, I can think of five teachers that I would pick out from all my education. So that's very important. When you see commercials that make you laugh, they're the ones that you remember.
Such feelings coming over me. There is wonder in most everything I see. Not a cloud in the sky, got the sun in my eyes, and I won't be surprised if it's a dream.
This is the end. Beautiful friend. This is the end. My only friend. The end. Oh, our love reflects the
cheese. Or how about this one?
All right, check it. Three aces. Nice, nicer. Whole house.
Ooh, nice. I got nothing.
Oh, I was like, good gracious, ass, four aces, I'm a dick.
What's going on? Get back to bed.
Feel young again. Centrum Silver.
The problem is most people suffer from ADHD, adult deficient humor disorder. All they see is the negative in the world. They're always complaining about things. There's nothing good, and they're just, I call them humor doomers. However, if you say, I want to incorporate humor into my life, you can turn things around. So the question is, where can you find humor? Where, because it's really all over the place if you know where to look for it. You can have buttons that have sayings on it. I had a red nose up here. I can't I don't know what happened to it, disappeared. But a red nose is really a wonderful thing to have. I used to, when I would go on a turnpike and then you go to pay your toll, I'd put the red nose on and get to the people that are taking the toll. 65% didn't react to it at all. 35% scowled. And only 15% laughed and thought it was funny. The other thing that I thought was interesting is picture you're in a traffic jam. Four lanes, nothing's moving. I would take out my nose and put it on. The person in the next car would look and they would turn to the person next to them and say, look at the person in the car over there with the red nose. The minute they would turn to tell them, I would take the nose off. When they would turn back, they'd put the nose back on. So, I mean, they're really, you sometimes when your significant other would say to you, could you go to the supermarket and bring some milk on your way home? And invariably, you get home and you realize you forgot. And of course, your significant other would say, you don't listen to me, you don't care about me. I talk and it's like I'm talking in the air. If you have a red nose, you put it on and you come in and say, I forgot to get the milk. And then everything has changed. So a red nose is very important. But what I do have is, if you don't use the red nose, this might fit people. This is a brown nose. You could use the brown nose instead. It's equally as good, and it works just the same way. You can have shirts. You don't have to say a thing. You can just wear these. There are a lot of companies you can find on the internet that have shirts. Want to stop asking how dumb you get? Some people take the challenge. It's true. Foot growing old, it takes longer. People, you're about to exceed the limits of my medication. And as you say, you don't have to do a thing. Just put these shirts on, and it works magic. If you can't laugh at yourself, let me do it. People are very willing to laugh at you. A great source of humor is kids. They come up with wonderful things to say, and if you took a notepad with you, and wrote down all the things that were funny, you have a whole routine. In school, teacher says, anything interesting happening? Little boy raised his hand and said, I saw a cat on the way home. Teacher says, was it dead or alive? Says it was alive. She says, how do you know? He said, because I pissed in its ear. Teacher says, you did what? He said, yeah, I went over to the cat and I went, psst. One of my talks, a senior person told me this about her grandson. He was 6 years old, walking around the house, and was cursing. So the father stops him and says, I don't appreciate what you're saying. I want you to give me three good words. He thinks, he says, is helicopter a good word? Yes. How about hippopotamus? Okay. God damn it, I can't think of a third letter. Teacher says to a class, what is this? Boy raises his hand and says, it's a freaking elephant. Teacher said, I want you to draw a picture of what does one of your parents do. So a little girl draws this, she brings it home, and the mother sends a note in and said, Dear Mrs. Johnson, when you asked my daughter to draw a picture, and she gave you this, I want to explain it. It's not a picture of me doing a pole dance and accepting money from people. I work at Walmart, and during the snowstorm, I was selling shovels. So this is me standing on a shovel and getting money for the people that were buying snow shovels. A little girl runs, God, please bring some clothes to the girls on my grandfather's computer. Now, it's important, if you leave here today and say, I'm going to look for humor, you're going to be surprised because humor is all over the place. Never appreciate what you have till it's gone. Toilet paper is a good example. There's no lifeguard in the gene pool.
Real love.
Thank you for not running the wall.
You're welcome.
Sharks have been spotted in the pool. They come out when they smell pee. Now, it says here, come feed the fish with your whole family. You don't have to do the whole family. You can pick out one or two kids you don't particularly like and use them, or if you want to do the whole family, you can. Now, I think this is wonderful that they can tell you ahead of time that there's going to be a problem. Now this gets even more specific of what might happen. Now there was an older lady who made Christmas cookies, and everybody loved them. And they would forever ask her, can I have the recipe? And she would say no. And they would beg her, and they would plead her, please give us the recipe. And she would say, I'm not giving out the recipe over my dead body. I love this one. I don't know how many people can even read the sign, but there it is. This is one of my favorites. I don't know if it was Walmart or a local bakery, but somebody calls up and says, could you please put on a cake, best wishes, Suzanne, and underneath that,
very good.
Takes time to get it, but it's you will see how often this happens. There's a weight loss center and a bakery next door, a candy store. And you'll see how often this comes up. Anybody caught exiting will be asked to leave. Now, again, this is interesting. For diabetes, they're selling candy. It's all the way up here. Don't take that extra cup of coffee before you go up on the wall. Now, we know that tragedy plus time equals comedy. Things are bad and then 24 hours later, they're okay. One point, you are nothing but an asshole. Some people never develop beyond this stage. Now, this is basically for the men. You can save a lot of health dollars by following this basic medical information. So go to a tree and pee on the tree. If it attracts ants, you have diabetes. If it dries fast, your sodium is high. It smells like meat, your cholesterol is too high. If you forget to unzip, it's Alzheimer's. If you miss the tree, it's Parkinsonism. If you peel your shoes, you have an enlarged prostate. And you can smell it, it's COVID-19.
My asthma. They said they'd fix it, but it didn't make any difference at all.
Well, sometimes doctors make mistakes. Anna, you have to try it twice as hard to fix them. Are you using your inhaler?
All the time. Go through one a week.
You sure you're using it right?
Do I look like an idiot?
No. Why don't you show me how your inhaler works?
No man has ever won the game of noticing anything different about me. Yep. We try and help. Guy says, "Can I help you?" to his wife, and she said, "It would be very helpful if you would peel half the potatoes." Steve Allen's parents were also in the show business. They would go to different hotels, and they would often ask for a room service. So when Steve Allen was on the road, he would ask for a room service. And he calls up and he says to the woman, "What's the soup du jour?" She says, "I'll be back with you in a minute." She calls back and says, "It's the soup of the day." I was on a speaking engagement in another city, and I landed in Philadelphia and no baggage. So you go to that little room where you report it, and I said, my baggage hasn't come. She said, "Has your plane landed?" They're all over the place. You just have to...
Hello?
Honey? Are you at the club?
Yes.
I'm at the mall now and I found this beautiful leather coat. It's only $1,000. Can I get it?
Well, sure, if you like it that much.
Okay, I also stopped by the Mercedes dealership and found a new model, you know, the one I really like.
How much?
$120.
Well, at that price, I want to book all the options.
Great! Oh, and one more thing, the house we wanted last year is back on the market. They're asking 1.5.
We'll make them an offer. But come in at 1.4.
Okay, I love you, baby.
I love you too.
Okay, bye.
Does anybody know whose phone this is?
In 1875, they made the first protective cup for hockey players. In 1975, it became mandatory for all hockey players to wear helmets. It took them 100 years to realize that the brain was also important. You can do that when you go home and you can let me know the answer. I don't know if you knew this, but Michelangelo's David was here in the United States. It was in Philadelphia, the Museum of Art. It was in New York. It was in Chicago and Atlanta on the West Coast. And it was very expensive to have this come over and for us to see. And thanks to McDonald's and Burger King and Kentucky Fried Chicken and Starbucks, they put up the money so that we could enjoy this. The David was here for 6 months, just left. Life is a vicious circle. At age 4, success is not being in your pants. 12, it's having friends. 16, having a driver's license. 20, it's having sex. 35, it's having money. 50, success is having money. 60 is having sex. Seventy is having a driver's license. 75 is having friends. And 80, success is not peeing in your pants. It just comes around. Now, it's very important to smile. I don't know what your experience has been, but I can tell you, at the hospital, I'd walk down a corridor and somebody would come, and I look at them, and they walk right past, like I wasn't there. They, no acknowledgement. The important thing is to smile at them. And you have to practice. So you're walking along, and you see them, and they get to a certain distance, and you go, and hopefully, they'll respond, they'll smile back. Because smiling changes the chemistry in your body. It reduces cortisol, which gives you anxiety, and increases dopamine, so it's very important. And here's some pictures just to make you smile.
White.
Strange things with weird people. Just change things in your life.
All right, Ms. Knight. Today I want to talk about giving 110%. Giving 100% means giving everything you got. Giving 110% means giving 10% more than is humanly possible. If we're going to win as a team, we need 100% of you guys giving 110% 100% of the time. If only 50% of you guys give 110%, and 50% of you guys give 100%, I guarantee you 100%, we'd only win 50% of our games. Suppose 75% of 110% gave only 30%, and 50% of 100% gave 25%, and 75% with 110%, we're not feeling 100%, then we'd be in a heap of trouble. That's why we need 100% of you guys giving 110% 100% of the time. Okay?
Everybody get that? Life is short, be the girl on the left. That's how you change things. Two most contagious things in the world are hatred, laughter. One's a disease, the other's a cure. What if you could live your life backwards? Well, you would die first, and you'd get that out of the way. And then you'd live in an old age home, and when you're young enough, they kick you out. And you get a gold watch and you go to work. And after 40 years, you're young enough to enjoy your retirement. Drink alcohol, you'd be in high school, be in college, then you get ready to party. You'd be in grade school, you become a kid again. You play, have no responsibilities, you become a little baby, you go back into the womb, you spend your last 9 months floating, very peaceful, and then you finish off as an orgasm.
Not bad.
No, it's not bad.
No, I never felt this way before.
Never.
Yes, I swear it's the truth, and I hope.
I hope you had the time of your life today. Thank you. Do you have any comments or questions or something funny from a grandchild to share? Yeah.
When my kids were old enough to hear about how babies were made, I told my son, and he said, oh, I have two kids, by the way. He said, oh, okay, so even Dad did that twice then.
See that? Kids tend to see things in a very concrete way, and that's what makes it funny. Thank you for that. Any other things to share? Questions?
This was very good. I enjoyed it very much.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so very much for being with us. We appreciate it. Thank you all so much for coming. Please enjoy the rest of your afternoon. I thank you all again. We'll see you next month. Have a great rest of your day.